Okay, hello everybody. We have CBM engineer Bill Hurd speaking to a CK. He came all the way from the East Coast just to visit us over here, and he's flying back tomorrow again.
Yeah, so be around a little bit.
What football league do you play for again?
What's that?
What football league do you play for?
CBM.
There you go.
That's actually what we called it back then. We internally referred to it as Commodore as CBM, so it's funny to say that. So yeah, for those that don't know, I'm Bill Hurd. I'm a recovering Commodore engineer. I don't know if the process of recovery ever stops. PTSD's taken its toll, or some of us are probably pretty a little proud of that PTSD that we had. But the I like to refer to Commodore as a Greek tragedy in three acts. Right? There was and I'm from the second act. I'm from that middle when Jack Tramiel, I was the engineer on what was his last computer that came from his vision, and then I did what was our first computer after he left. So I got to see that transition. And I know all the people that know what it's like to have worked with Jack Tramiel and without. So I'm from that era. Hold on a second. Ugh. This room's hot. Too many bodies, too many computers.
I called engineering, the hotel engineering. They said they're going to fix it. Yeah, sure.
Well, that part of my story talks about they used to turn off the heat at Commodore on the weekends. Of course, we had work on the weekends. We worked at night. They turned off the air conditioning. And I had long hair and everything. And as I would work, I would drip sweat on the board. And so every 11 minutes, I would like spray it down and plug it back in, and it'd start working again. And that's just some of the things we did to keep working in spite of Commodore back then. So let me start at the beginning, which was the beginning for me when I joined Commodore. I've never been to school for electronics. I was self-taught, but then I got with a company called Pennsylvania Scale Company. And I got to learn from other engineers. So I actually did was able to pick up a lot of my trade craft from that. And so I did analog, real high precision analog. I learned about ground loops. I learned about FCC. I learned about digital. I learned about the 6502. I knew it hands down, in and out. And I worked my way up through an engineer. Excuse me. So at some point, I stopped getting along with my boss. So it was time to start looking for a job. And a friend of mine, Hedley Davis, just looked in the newspaper, sitting in the lunchroom, says, "Hey, have you ever heard of Commodore? They're hiring." I think it's that night or the next night, I'm in being interviewed. And I go in to sit, and I'm with the first guy. His name's Frank Hughes. I really wanted to impress this guy. You know, I could really use this job. That'd be a cool job to have. And it didn't work. I'm like watching his body language. I'm trying to "Hi, how you doing? You're smart, but I'm smart too." Didn't work, right? So I'm knowing I'm blowing this interview. So I start to talk with Bob Russell next. And he's like laid back. I had to learn that about Bob. But at some point then, he said, as an example, by the way, we have a royalty in the house, Dr. Leonard Tramiel over here.
Oh,
Jack Tramiel's son.
Probably need to leave at around 2:30, something like that, yeah.
All right, yeah, I'm going to catch you for a few minutes. Maybe we'll even take a break or something like that. Now, if I say anything wrong, it's not. If you know the other side of the story, and I got one for you, let me know.
Okay.
And you may recognize some of the people we're talking about. So I was talking about Bob Russell when he went to interview me, and he said, load X05, and I mutter under my breath, I'm like, A205. And he tries another one. He's like, store accumulator, something. I mutter the opcode. And at that point, I saw his body language change. And I, excuse me a second. Got to learn to breathe when I do these things. I saw his body language change. And so he said, "Well, we'd like you to swing by, come by Commodore." Well, he said it in such a laid-back way, I didn't know I was coming in for an interview. So I meet with a guy named Shiraz Shivshi, and Shiraz isn't in his room, and I go into his office, and he's got his desk facing the wrong way. So I plop myself right down in Shiraz's seat. Shiraz comes in the room. "Excuse me, you are in my seat. Now I've blown it again." And then he goes, "Where's your resume?" I'm like, I thought I was going to dinner with Bob Russell. I didn't bring a resume. And then, you know, I'm really out the door at this point. And then Ray Hughes comes in, and he's got my resume. And at that point, when I'm talking with Shiraz, I start telling him about the digital scales I used to do. You know, since that's what I did, I'd better be an expert in it. I was talking about this weighing instrumentation, and he got to correct me. And that made all the difference, because I was talking about a reference weight and stuff, and he's like, it's a reference pass. So if you want a job, make it out, lay it out there where the boss can correct you. And that's it. Suddenly I saw his body language change. I knew I was going to get somewhere. So my first week at Commodore, at CBM, and this is in the MOS building. You've been to the MOS building?
I actually was not.
No? Well, it's painted psychotic blue,
the big one.
Yes?
Yeah.
It's painted psychotic blue in the upstairs. It makes you energetic, right? And we're shoved in there, three people to a room. There would have been four, except you needed a door, right, so you could come in. So we're shoved in the upstairs of the MOS building. But everywhere you walk, there's game sounds. There's cool things going on around you. And, you know, half of these people are actually working, you know? And so it's a really cool place. And one of the things I had read about when I was back at the Pennsylvania Scale Company was about the amount of photons, the amount of energy they contain, and how related to the electrical potential itself and how they can measure it. And I can't remember any of those things. But when I got there, on my second week, I was in the lab where they do the chip stuff. And I like chip stuff. And the engineer turned on the light, said, we're in NTSC mode, and turned the light back off of his microscope. And he's looking at a chip under the microscope. I'm like, did you just use photons to trip the cells of a register and a chip? He goes, yeah, mm-hmm. And I'm like, oh, I'm working in the right place. This is cool. I'd only heard about wafers. But later, we're throwing wafers like this, and they shatter like glass, as it turns out, because I think they're made of glass. The wafers have a cleave edge on them. And if you did it right, you could cleave a wafer yourself into pieces, four pieces, or it's four or five, depending on the type of silicon. Well, I would put it against the side of the table and hit it sharply, and no matter what, glass went everywhere. I'd be shaking it out of my hair. By the way, I had long hair back then. And it turns out what you're supposed to do is take a pinpoint and hit it in the middle, then it'll cleave. So all this, whenever they go to vacuum my carpet, there'd be like this clunking noise of broken wafer coming up in the vacuum here. So one of the things then when I first settled in was I sat down and I learned some timings. The guy that was quitting, and when I was hired, it turns out I was hired as a technician. I just didn't know it. And Commodore was a great place for doing whatever it is you could rise to. So I wandered the halls. The guy I was supposed to work there for wasn't there the first week, and so I got to wander the halls. Well, pretty soon I'm in the hardware lab. They were going to have me write code so I went from technician to a code writer the first day. But by the end of the week, they figured out I understood hardware. What had happened was then.
Right here.
Thank you. This is going to make a horrible video, Robert. We'll have to edit this out.
Okay.
I'm nervous because Leonard's here, to be honest. That's the first time I've ever been nervous about it. No, because you're one of the reasons I think.
There's a microphone there.
Well, everybody can hear me, though, right?
Absolutely.
Okay, thank you. So what I had done at home, though, was I had done this thing where I had a processor jump on the bus with a video processor, and then they shared this bus back and forth. Well, when I see what they called the TED project, that's what it did. And the guy was leaving the TED project, and suddenly I'm there and I'm going, is this where you're jumping on the bus and getting off the bus? He said, yeah, how do you know about that? I'm like, I have one at home. So at that point, when they said, well, who should you replace you? They pointed at me. So by my second or third week, I'm now on this TED project, which meant text display. We're going to talk more about the TED. It got a good rap, then it got a bad rap. So that was kind of how I climbed into that position. And the TED chip meant text display. And it was a well thought out, and Leonard, I am going to look at you at some point here, because the TED system, in my opinion, was the last system designed by Jack Tramiel. It was a top-down thing, or the way we were told, and Shiraz would go up the mountain, you know, come back and interpret for us, right? Because Shiraz, when he went to show it to me then, He opened his Commodore brand horizontal filing cabinet, and it didn't fall apart this time. Took out a Timex spec. Yeah, they were mad, weren't they? They made office furniture, then summer furniture, and then calculator. You know, they used a lot of the same resources to make those.
And the body of the pet.
Yeah, right. So the thing that was our cabinet was also the body of a pet, and we saw it. You'd find a pet color on the inside, you knew they'd scrap it. So the text display was supposed to be a minimalist system. And it was supposed to be minimalist under threat of life from our boss, Jack Tramiel. And it had 9 chips. And we got it. It was on a stone tablet. It said, there will be 9 chips. Add a chip and dock. Well, and when I kind of took over the design, I showed them they needed a reset circuit and that you couldn't just hook a 7407 and get a reset circuit. Now, I'm from the scale company where we had to make the reset circuit work, right? And so I said, I'm adding a chip. They said, been nice knowing you. Later. Well, turns out they didn't fire me. Matter of fact, the whole time I worked there, I was never afraid of being fired. I was afraid of not getting my job done, not getting the product out. And it turns out that our interpretation was he didn't care, he being Jack Tramiel, didn't care how many chips there was, but he wanted was a minimalistic amount. And this was a $49 system. Can you pull up C116? Go under Ted? Yeah, C116. And you can't see that very well. But this thing was a work of art. And when I say this was designed from the top down, I mean, this was all of our different companies involved. The case was designed by a guy named Ira Galensky. Go ahead and show the back. See where it says backside? See, normally I'd be waving one, but I wasn't going to try and get it through. Not yet. Oh, no thanks. Thanks anyway, so. But I wasn't going to try and get it through TSA, and I wasn't going to ship all my stuff here and then have the box go missing and lose most of my life. So go ahead and show the C116 inside. So, now you really can't see, but this thing is really, really packed. It's the equivalent of high density stuff is today, and it was beautiful. And go back to the backside. If you can see, you can see the connectors, but they take up every bit of the amount. We changed the joystick connector, and everybody hated it. But, oh, you're the biggest makers of joystick games in the world. Well, yeah, we are, but this needed to fit. And we didn't want to compete with a Commodore 64. You want a Commodore 64, buy a Commodore 64. This is different. This is a $49 text display. No sprites. My computer has sprites, not this one. And so this, to me, was a well-thought-out system. And it had multiple members of the family that go to C264. Now that's a real 264. Yeah, what's the difference between a C264 and a Plus 4? About $199. All joke, right? And they put software in. The software gets a bum rap, but how can any software be worth $199 back then when this was designed to be a $79 system? And it would have sold for that. When Cone tried to sell them then, when they dumped them, they couldn't keep them in stock. So again, I called this a well-designed family, but it needed follow-through. It needed guidance, and this again was started, at the time. What you missed was I was saying that I'm from that rare time of I knew what it was like to work when Jack Tramiel was the boss, and then when he wasn't. So I know everybody that was in engineering during that time. And so I got to see it when we were being guided. And so what we had actually done was gone to the developers with pre-boards 9 months early and given them a chance to write software and stuff. You cannot release a computer without software. So we did everything for the family that we could. Go to the 364. Yep. And here's a third member of the family. And this has, does anybody know who did the sound chips for this? Anybody remember any of my stories? The guys that did the TI speak and spell. And that was magic back then, the speak and spell. I mean, my God, it talked. It was on the movie E.T., right? And it was Dr. Richard Wiggins and Tom Brightman. You know Tom, right? And so they came in, and John Figgins did a product called Magic Desk. which is supposed to talk. So now there's an operating system, there's voices, there's sounds. This is a complete thought out system. It has 121 colors. Anybody know why it's not 128? Right, eight shades of black is still black. So, but we had a nice chorus of, you know, colors and stuff. And, you know, we also, it's an early example of a single chip computer system design, where it's just really centered on that. That was good and bad because the chip designers ended up doing the design of the TED system, basically. What I did is walk around with the schematics, but, you know, I was kind of the caretaker when I first picked up on it. But they had done the design. And one of the things they had done was use the data lines to scan the keyboard. Well, a hardware designer wouldn't think of doing that. And it's, if I pick this up, here's the outside world. Here's data lines to the processor, outside world data line, you know, radiation, input. So, but I missed it. I mean, I knew it was there, sort of, but I really wasn't making input onto it yet. And then one day, we had a joystick, and we got it close to the screen. Black dots appear. What's going on? Oh, D0, one of the data line scans keyboard, comes out to that button. Oh, the data line of the processor is now on the high voltage part of, you know, a TV monitor. Why isn't it crashing the processor? I put all the wire to crash the processor. Okay. So we needed a change. My boss, this was the first time I was threatened with my job at the time, a guy named Joe Krasuki. Because when I looked at the schematic, I started laughing. And he's like, what's up? And I said, I missed it. I didn't own it. I should have, you know. And he got mad that I was laughing at myself. He's like, well, fix it or you're fired. Okay, not a problem. Didn't need to threaten me, but not a problem. So he comes back 2 hours later, and I'm playing Wizard of War. He looks at him. Aren't you? He's pissed. Aren't you? I just point. You know, point at the Wizard of War game. He didn't get it, so he gets madder at me, and I point and smile again. What we had done was taken an extra 6 foot of joystick cord, soldered it on. I had opened the monitor and wrapped the joystick cord around the high voltage section of the tube. So I've proven it's fixed. But he's still pissed at me. So I'm just like, you know, the 2 hours. So that was typical. We started to get these rhythms where we had to fix things. Now I had to add a chip to do that, and what I did, we had an axiom of not using, we didn't want to be beholden to somebody else's chip company, to parts. Overseas, you know, so I actually had our stock from overseas, which I wasn't supposed to have. Sam got mad that I had that list. But I actually designed from it. I would design, if something had a million in stock, that's why there's 6406s in, you know, or 7406s in the C128. I'm sorry, in the TED. So one of the other things then that we saw with the chip, because I'd learned to start thinking inside the chip, because the chip designer sat right next down to me, near me and stuff. And one of the things that happened early on was when we got the TED up close to one of the monitors, we'd also get a black sparkle. Well, if you build a chip, you have to test it. And to test it, you have to start the counters from somewhere. And there was no reset line on this thing, so to speak of. So I went to him, what I figured out, I'm a good old fashioned television repairman. I went around touching stuff and I found a pin on the TED that would cause the counters to reset. And I went to him, I'm like, you guys are using a pin on, they're like, how'd you know? It's like, they had tried to use, if the pin went above 8 volts, it would become a reset line for the chip. Well, the chip designers don't think about high impedance in electromagnetic field, and I was tripping the reset counters. So in the early TED, you'll actually see a pair of diodes sitting on top of each of the chip. So everybody knows what I mean, a TED, I mean the TED chip, right? Mm-hmm. So I know one of the things I thought about. So as I said, Ira Valensky had designed the TED case, the whole TED series. And he had come to us with a joystick. And I had looked at the joystick, and at the time it was thinner than it is now. And it was a hard tool, it was probably worth about $20,000. And so, you know, at one point, I'm arguing with Ira, and he's like, no, it's designed. I don't know if you ever heard him say, it's designed. So every finally the attention shifts and you hear snap. And I'm like, sorry. He's pissed at me. I had to watch it. Ira used to teach me Japanese, so I had to watch what he taught me from then on. But I had snapped it to prove a lesson, prove a point. Because in my mind, we can't make millions of these. And in truth, it was harder to break than I thought, but the fact I broke it meant that it was still no good. So that was one of the things where I got into trouble with the chip designer and then recovered. So as we get closer to the CES show then for the TED, at the CES show, one of my stories is about John Fagans, who had written the Magic Voice thing, but we didn't meet. He had the ROMs, and we had built in ROM sockets. But we didn't meet till we were actually in the suite with that Kmart is coming to in 20 minutes. And we plug him in, and instead of saying, welcome to the Magic Voice, it goes, turn off and on, the exact same. So we don't have tools. We've got a soldering iron, no solder, no wire. I don't know why I had a soldering iron. So me and John Fagans are sitting, squatting on the fireplace sill. We've got the board out. It's the first time we've used these two empty sockets, and they were saved for additional stuff for John. And I realized I had told the PC board layout person he had wanted to swap some gates. And I could see the schematic in my mind, again, back when my brain worked. And I realized that some were Qs and some were Q-nots. And I'll bet the PCB designer had missed that. So using cannibalizing one of the TEDs, so now I'm down to one system, I took some jumper wires off of it and soldered them onto the bottom of this board, burning my fingers and everything. We turn it over, we plug it in, it goes, welcome to the Magic Desk. And it's like, cool, you know, from memory, there on the thing. Meanwhile, the head of Commodore International is yelling at us. As I'm walking down the hall to walk away, three blue suits combined is Kmart. I'd made it by like 4 minutes. And after that, there wasn't anything that shook me up about working a Commodore. That was like that bet moment where you said, I can do this. You know, it doesn't matter how much time we have or whatnot. So by the end then, we ran into a problem. And now Jack Tramiel has left. Oh, pull up the picture on the right place. I got to the point where I couldn't remember exactly how much direction had come from Jack Tramiel, the fact that they had existed at the same time as him, because when he left, this is CS show, so obviously he's there. But this just appeared, a guy from New York Times brought me this. And I was like, there it is, there's proof. This is the 364 in his hand, and that's a 264 in his hand. And I didn't put those in his hands that day, but my fingerprints are all over the inside and the outside of those, because there's like 10 of them, all right? Better fun. And so after he leaves, marketing feels somehow empowered. They'll steer the ship. They'll keep us moving. They did just dandy selling the C64 after all. In fact, a good computer should sell itself. That became the attitude. Any computer that doesn't sell itself must not be a good computer. Just look at the TED system, for example. So they didn't get that we shouldn't compete with ourselves. They wanted another Commodore 64. If you want a Commodore 64, go buy a Commodore 64. This is a business machine, text display. So finally, this abomination shows up. Anybody know what this is?
Yes.
Everybody know what this is?
Yes.
It's a C16 single-sided board. The Japanese engineer telexed me saying, I'm sorry, and I didn't know what for, and this showed up the next day, you know, somewhere around that timing. And he's like, they made me do it. So, and that actually sold overseas, I'm told. It had a following. I don't know why. You know, and at the time, you know, these were new chips that had come out, the 16K by 4 DRAMs, and it was sort of based on that. So I wanted to back up a little bit and talk about the C64 and the C64 era, because when I got there, the C64 didn't work. It acted like it worked. It worked good enough to sell you one, but it had some timing problems, and it had sparkle and those kind of things. Does anybody know the different rev chips? Can you look at an older one and tell when it's got an older rev chip, all the sparkle and stuff? Well, they had these chips, rev 4 and rev 5, where the timing didn't work. And so they made a team to address the issues and or cover them up as best I could. And one of the things they did, I really like this, what they did, because it's Commodore attitude. It's what we did. It used to sparkle light blue dots on dark blue, wherever, you know, on a screen. One of the things they did was they went in and made it so it was sparkling dark blue on dark blue. Well, you can't see that. It's still sparkling, but you can't see it. So one of the ways they fixed that was they went to the Rev 7 big chip, which tried to improve the timings and whatnot, and they went to a beryllium lead frame for the big chip, which helps get heat out of it. Well, these things became a hot commodity, and if you had something sitting on the bench and you come back for lunch, your R7 big chip would be out, and they would have taken the time to put an R5 in. I mean, that's what I always thought. But you look at the screen and know somebody just ripped you. It got so bad you go to the bathroom and come back, and they didn't have time to get it all the way in. You know, it'd be half in. So I learned a power I had coming from engineering, which was I could call downstairs. So I called downstairs and said, send up a tube of R7 big chips. I put a sign out and said, take one. Tube disappears quick. But I went, take one. Eventually, I saturated the market. They stopped disappearing. We could all get back to work. We had the same problem with Amiga RAM. You know, at the beginning of the Amiga saga, you'd go to lunch, come back, and Marble Madness wouldn't run. You'd be out of RAM because somebody took your RAM out. I had a C128D on my desk because you could tell where somebody tried to pry into it, not knowing it's a D, you know, thinking it's an Amiga.
Bill, why are they doing this? Why are they picking
parts? The RAM was hard to get. And if marketing wanted some, we were just talking about how marketing stole Dave Haney's, marketing promised a C128 to Dave Haney, or to Drew over there, and went and took it off Dave Haney's desk, because they're marketing, they're in power. Huh. They're driving the ship, you know, Commodore being a matter of fact, we'll get to that. And, I used to have all these stories memorized. So during this time, there were some are urban legends, some are exaggerations. Again, Leonard, correct me on any of these. One of the things, it was very important for us to ship before Christmas. If the unit came back, fine, we still sold it to you for Christmas. You know, we'll fix it for you in January, don't worry. And there had been a rule when I first got there, which was, don't go downstairs. Production wouldn't let the engineers in. Matter of fact, security guard, turn you right around, escort you out. Well, I got to Joe Spiteri. Did you guys end up with Spiteri?
Yeah.
Well, I ended up drinking with him. And the rule changed. You know, I thought, we can help, right? So some things we couldn't help with, and the one I remember is, because I was working at QA station, so I saw it happen, you know, the transpiration of it. Was a skid of bad 64s, marked clearly bad, gets moved off in that direction. Well, that's the good direction. Sign lane saying bad, still laying on the floor. We shipped it. I'm sure we did. And, and that's just what we did during that rush. And it was part of the attitude. Correct me if that sounds too much over the top for it. But one of the things we used to do then was also ship to the trailers outside. We had a trailer park. Have you been to the Westchester building?
I was never down at MOS, except for that.
And then we moved down to Westchester. Yeah. And so we were shipping the trailers. It is the urban legend that I tend to believe, and that backfired on us. You're not really supposed to call it shipping when it's still sitting on your property, even if it's the very edge of your property. And so what happened then was the security guards went into business for themselves and started unloading those trailers at night. And so they go to open a few of them, and sure enough, I saw FBI escorting security out. We had all new security guards the next week. I had to reintroduce myself to everybody, you know. And so that's the kind of, you know, that our RMA department did the same thing. I found I could get IEEE cables from the RMA department, which were hard to get, and I go down there and they're gone. Well, they had been doing RMAs with the return address to their home house. So they didn't like that either. So some of the things we were doing back in the Commodore 64 then was the DRAMs. The timings didn't work, and I had to fix these for the 128. But the DRAM timings were, what they were doing in production was actually putting a capacitor on the control signals. Well, you can't do that. It's against every rule, but you know what? It makes it appear to work better. And during this time, we also got involved. We sued Micron, the DRAM manufacturer. Clearly, you're not making them right. We have to put, Well, they sued us back. Clearly, are you using them wrong? And the answer was both. And it was the two on the end that would always fail. And it came down to, at the end of the day, the Commodore 64 didn't have enough resolution in its main clock to make the DRAM control signals really well. And so again, something to remember for the 128. So that goes back to why we were always saying, it doesn't work. And you couldn't leave one on for 20 minutes and not come back and not have it rebooted, it seemed like to us. So the other thing we saw, who knows what chip failed the most in the old days?
VLA?
CIA?
6522?
No. The PLAs?
PLAs?
PLAs.
Yeah, remember those?
Yeah.
A2S100s, not the A2SR replacement for it. They would get the purple-green crud, which was a passivation layer stuff was getting in, and you could actually see it under the microscope. So I'm just curious, has anybody heard that story before about what was knocking down the PLAs? Well, that's why they were hard to get, and it wasn't until years later I found out they were putting too much boron in the passivation layer. You're supposed to seal these things with a seventh layer, and it was getting in there. So it's one of the cool things about working around a chip company, you got to see those kind of things. So, after the TED chip series, I started working on something called the Commodore LCD. Can you go to the LCD?
Yep.
Go ahead and make that big. Mm. If it'll get big. I thought it'd be bigger.
I forget Windows. There you go.
Ah, yes.
Maximize.
Yeah, I have no button to move that.
There you go.
All right.
There
you go. This has a really cool keyboard by Natsumi that feels like... Can I hold this?
Yes.
Robert knows I talk there with something in my hands. the Mitsumi keyboard looks like has death, but it's for 1984, this was a really cool thing. We owned an LCD company. We were we were the only makers of American glass, and it was Eagle Pitcher that we had bought. So here we are, positioned to make our own Commodore LCD computers. Now I'll tell you, I did the 128, but I started on this, and this one should have been made instead of the 128, if I were to be honest. Because this was innovative at the time. And it was going to be battery powered. The only thing that was out there that was near, the TRS, Radio Shack had some of these computers. Well, by then our CEO was a guy named Marshall Smith who came to us from U.S. Steel, except years later, U.S. Steel said they never heard of it. And with the internet, I still couldn't find it now that there's an internet. And he had, this is not urban legend. This unfortunately is fact. He had had a meeting or a dinner with the president of Tandy, and he told him there was no money in mobile computers. I had an article up about it. I said, this is what happens when you listen to the competition. And so we didn't know it at the time, but this thing would not sell. I had done the initial architecture on this, and then when I went to the C128, which I'll talk about how that happened, I took the MMU design I was working on and just took it with me. So this had an MMU that would work. We were doing our own graphics controller in the chip department, and this would have been a great computer way ahead of its time. We had room for something called a CD-ROM in it. Right? Yeah, this guy from Mitsumi came to show it to us. Flew across. I had read Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy, and I was convinced that we could make a personal information system out of something like this. So this would have been really cool. So I'm working on this, and we acquired a guy named Jeff Porter who came from Bell Atlantic, and he had done we got him to do like modems and stuff. We were just looking at, you have your modem?
Yeah, the record.
he made this one work and then made the 1200, the guy named Jeff did. And so the, I'm going to put this down, I'm going to hold this for a while, if you don't mind. So we built a telephone interface right into the LCD. Who did that before, right? Modem built right in. We got the idea looking at our TI-99 that we were paying like $900 a month from. Turns out like Chuck Puddle rented it 10 years earlier and we were still paying leases on it. So Jeff was in a position to take this over, and Jeff eventually became the Vice President of Commodore Engineering. So what had happened was I was sitting in the lab and I was working on something for the LCD. And I kept hearing behind me, I kept hearing somebody go, "That shouldn't be. How is that not working?" Pretty soon I'm like, "What's going on?" As Fred Bowen's sitting with another engineer and they're working on this machine called a D128. In the analyzer, every time it goes to capture something, it was capturing three cycles. And he said, "How can that be?" And he'd start it again. I knew that if you had a contention on the bus, it would bounce the ground on the probe. So I turned, I said, "You've got contention on your bus, let me see your PLA terms." He had photocopied it sideways, so it cut off a row, or a column, right? So he had two things turned on at the same time, so I said, "Here, right there, I can tell it's an L and an H, and you missed one, and you don't have it here, shut up." Well, Fred Bowen looks over his glasses at me, and he goes, I turn back, and Fred and I look at each other, and I'm like, "Oh no, I know." And a week later, I was on the 128. That was kind of a he pushed, I pulled type thing, or he pulled and I pushed type thing, because I was interested in this. So they made me the co-engineer on it, but it was going to be funny. It was going to have some video processor. It wasn't going to be compatible with anything, and I think it was 6809 and 6. And I made a decision. I said, "Let's go for Commodore 64 compatibility." And Fred Bowen was right there with me on this. See, the one thing when we had done the TED, we had gone to the CES show, I did have a woman come up to me and says, "Your new computer," she said, "I just spent 9 months writing software, educational software," and she showed it to me. This little fuzzy thing would get all happy if you did the math right and stuff. And she said, "My software won't run on your new computer. That hurts me, you know, as a developer." And, you know, I tried to explain it's a business thing, but I remembered that. So when we were looking at what the 128 could be, we said C64, and we thought of it as a way to give back, a way to support. But then it became and we didn't realize we were walking backwards into a good decision, what we still think is a good decision. And that is, it allowed us to, if we were going to be C64 compatible, we could sell a computer that already had a software base. But I could get you new stuff too. In fact, it's one of the biggest software bases. So it was our way of kind of jimmying the door open. But we never said it's 100% compatible. My friend in marketing said that without telling us first. Matter of fact, he put out a marketing release saying that he was the project manager on the Commodore 128. Problem was, I hadn't met him yet. So I walked down and introduced myself. And said, "It's too late for this one, but can you talk to us before you make any more claims like that?" But we took it on. We said, let's be Commodore 64 compatible. Let's be 100%. And so that's kind of where that came from. That was it pushing backwards into us. So to do those, the 128, go ahead to the 128 folder.
I gotta do the whole thing over again, don't I?
So the Commodore 128, we had 5 months to do it in before CES show. And we knew we had about four custom ICs that we needed to make. We had the MMU I brought with me. We had an 8502 chip, which is a 6502. And we had a bigger PLA, some other things. So we had to develop all of those. It's 5 months so that it would work when we got to CES. With the chip emulators, one to the right. And go big with it if you can, please. So this is how we made a board pretend to work. I didn't even stop at wire wrap. Because this something this complex, we would have spent more time wire wrapping than we would in troubleshooting than we would actually have even used it. So this was the first 128 prototype board. And each of these boards plugged in is actually emulating a custom IC that doesn't yet exist. Go to the bottom of the board. Just click left or right.
There we go.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
So it's unbelievable this work. But see, I had an advantage in that I already had an operating system written for me. I didn't need the programmers to catch up. I first got C64 mode working. And, you know, normally you'd have to get a little bit, the programmers get a little further, you get a little further. But, if you know, so I had a couple, I had a month and a half to make all these changes and make all of this stuff work. During this time, some of the things I had to debug was DRAMs would fail. And in one case, the DRAM would fail and it'd barf all over the screen. It'd go blip, blip, blip. Well, it didn't jive up to the logic analyzer. There was no way to find out what instruction it was doing because it was DRAMs failing in the memory. So what I did was I took a light pin to the screen. They would always put an at sign in this one spot. So I circled the spot and I put a light pin on it. And next time it barfed, it captured it on the logic analyzer. And we were able to find that there was a ground lifting. You know, that's why you see some of these big wires and stuff. We had to maintain the ground integrity of it. So that was one of the kind of things. And so what started to happen was we would fix something every night, or no longer than a night to fix something. So then came the Z80, everybody's favorite topic. How many people know why the Z80 is in the 128?
CPU.
What's that?
CPU.
Well, it does do that.
Oh, isn't it a door?
That's when it saved our lives. So the reason I put the Z80 directly in it was, one, the CPM cartridge didn't work very well on Commodore 64s. Then they worked even less well when they got the new VIC chips. And the power supply also needed another 0.6 amp. To carry it. Well, I wasn't going to build the power supply bigger, which is our first switching power supply. And so we looked at it and we said, let's put the Z80 on the inside. So by the next day, because we decide this at night, the next day we've got the Z80 in there and we're making it so it actually works, whereas the CPM cartridge didn't. Well, what we did was we ended up with a dual processor system, kind of walking backwards into it again. And what it also meant was now we've got a dual operating system, actually three now, because we have Commodore 64 mode, we've got CPM mode, and we've got the C128 mode. And 80 column chip. So we said, hey, let's do an 80 column. I made a serious error. The guy who ran the chip group came and said, can you use the chip from the Z8000 system, which is going nowhere. We had the Z8. Had anybody heard of the Z8000 system? It's going nowhere. And so they take the 80 column chip out, and I asked him, I said, is it 6845 compatible, which is a good old chip? Mm-hmm. They said, yeah. I should recognize the tone of voice. It's like, yeah, that's it. It's compatible. I thought they knew what it meant when I asked. Well, that thing, if you've ever read all the things that went wrong with the 8563 chip, go ahead to see if you can find, get out of your way. They went through rev after rev of this chip, and the guy who's in charge of it, he was actually fairly brilliant. He had some of the patents under the 68,000 in Motorola. Is that the only thing in there? There's an 8563 at the top. So where's your laser pointer? So every time we get a rev of this chip, it works less better instead of more better.
That's on the side.
And at one point, we're almost ready for CES, and they had installed something called backbias, which is where they try and create, using capacitive charging, they try and make the substrate go down below the voltage so the NMOS gates would shut all the way off and draw less power. So right in the middle of our CES cycle, they're trying to reduce power, which I could have cared less about at that time. And once I learned what it was, they said, oh, it turns out it makes it slower. Well, speed's important when you're trying to make one single dot in an 80-column display. I knew that little tab right there was connected to the substrate. So what I did was I ran a jumper from here to here, and it got better. It actually started to work. It pissed him off. I loved it. Because I'm shorting out his back bias generator, right? This thing's working like this, and it's connected to ground. But it's one problem more we fixed. So as we're getting ready for the CS show, we had another problem. He couldn't pull up the signals fast enough at the beginning of the line. So again, because of the way charges build in chips, So on an 80-column display, the very left column really didn't work. So instead of saying ready, it looked like Eddie. You know, just kind of, it would kind of come up and start. So I put like 200 ohm pull-up resistors on it. I mean, it got hot. Pissed him off again because I'm abusing his chip, but loved it, right? And then when we went to the CES show, though, however, CPM wanted to do it in opposite. They wanted to have green with black dots. And I, so now I made resistors that pulled it down, and so we would decide whether it was a CPM system or a regular system, and we would put these resistors in there, you know, knowing that the chip only had to last a day or two. Meanwhile, we're making thousands of these 8563 chips. We had a we had a jar of them. It said, guess how many good chips are in here, or how many working 85.6? And it was a trick question. There were none. They would they were getting a yield of about one or two a day. And during the CES show, they would actually bring them to us. And we would get another system working out there. Well, the final rev came out 2 weeks before CES. And it had fixes we needed, and it was completely broken. It, when you wrote to it, if you wrote the address you wanted to write to in the data, it would get one right and one wrong, so it would write this data to that address, this data to this address. It's called synchronization. You can't have a clock from one thing and the other clock and they're not meshing because you can't agree when to look at the data. I asked the guy, I said, did you use synchronization, which is a known technique? And he said, well, statistically, it'll never work, it'll never be perfect, so I didn't try. Well, 1 times 10 to the 27th is a lot better than 1 times 10 to the 9th. We were blowing write cycles to this chip just left and right because it had its own clock. It had its own little crystal. And nobody believed us. We went down to the chip lab where he demonstrated that his was fine. It turns out he's using a, like 3 revs old. And he's doing it in basic. We said, why are you running in basic when you load the final? He says, well, it crashes when I run it at full speed. I'm going, we're running at full speed. It's the only speed we have. And at that point, finally, Bob Ola, head of the chip group, says, that's it. You're, you know, something has to be done about this. And so first off, he made them stop pretending it's broken. They were supposed to rev it again. They didn't get done in time. So this was our answer. This board we got done in 8 hours. It cost $1,200 a board back then. And what's on here is a phase lock loop from the Commodore 64. And it phase locked the 80 column chip to the 40 column. So the screen just changed. But this board is the only reason we were able to make it to CES show. What it is there's a delay line. And I didn't run one last little trace because you could run this jumper wire and pick the amount of delay. And so for every combination, we'd open the case, move the wire till it worked, and close the case. And that's how we got the 80 column chip to work. So if these were the kind of things we were fixing daily. So then the voice guys show back up with their cartridge, the magic voice, and this is the speak and spell guys again, plugs it into the 128, and it goes, actually, and it sounds like, you know, that death, you know, thing. And what happened is, the way they had designed it, they had assumed that they would just take over the Commodore 64 bus with prejudice. There's these lines that are normally pulled for, you know, they're left in like one place, the game line, game and X-ROM. Well, they hooked gates to them. They said, you ready to go? Oh, sorry. And so right at the last minute, they would take the reset vector, FFFC. Well, it doesn't know anything about setting up the MMU or anything. It's saying, I'll take over the reset of the computer from you. And we're like, we have stuff to do. We have to set up the MMU, we've got to turn on 128 mode, we've got to do this, and then we'll turn on 64 mode and hand it back to you. So there was nothing I could do about this, the way this cartridge was designed. It would just take that reset vector. So this is about 3 or 4 in the afternoon. So what we did, we told all management, go home, we'll fix it, because we couldn't fix anything with them around. And we inverted the reset line. Just literally, I just moved the two wires. And so now the Z80, which comes when the reset line's low, he wakes up first. Well, he goes to 0000. So he goes, is that cartridge out there? All right, he would set it up, and they go, here you go! And he'd shove it over at the speech cartridge. So one of the ways where our reputations got bigger about it was we had called somebody and said, we need the opcodes to do this. And we plugged them into the data I/O by hand, so the next morning when they came in, this thing was able to boot by doing the Z80. So you said about the boot process. Now it actually saved our life, because if the Z80 wasn't in there, I would not have been Commodore 64 compatible to this point. Hmm. Now, one of my favorite stories about learning what Commodore 64 compatible meant was, you know the font that's on the Commodore 64? We call it the Atari font. Anybody hear from Atari? It's because we stole it from the ROM. We used to make their ROMs. So here's Urban Legend for you. We used to, Atari. I'll tell you guys about the camera. We had the posters that said, "We'll have your ROMs by Christmas." It showed Santa by the DOS building. Elton Southern had one in his office. It showed Santa with a bag of ROMs. "We'll have it ready for your Christmas." It meant to people like Atari and such. Well, the very last year, they said, "Where's the ROMs?" "Well, they're coming. Where's the ROMs?" "You're not getting them." And we did. And that's the truth I heard. I don't know if you've heard different, but we stiffed them for their ROMs.
What year would that have been?
83?
Yeah. I was busy getting a PhD.
And it's just like, we didn't need their business anymore. So we made sure we closed the door on the way out. So we had a copy of their character ROM. Well, in the 128, we said, why don't we make it look better? In 64 mode.
Why did you just use my character stuff?
Yours?
The Jaguar or the other?
No, the Pesky.
Well, here's what. Because we did, we put in a better character set than what we call the Atari set, which was in the 64.
Right.
So I paid people down in the testing department to tell me if there was a shitstorm headed up my way. He calls, they're on their way up. All right, thanks. We had a movie, Dirty Harry, had just come out. So I even do my Dirty Harry impression. I'm like chewing on a sandwich. This rabble comes down the hall, pitchforks and stuff. We have proof it's not compatible. Come with me to the lab. So we go in, and I plug in the cartridge. I'm still chewing the sandwich. And it goes, koala paint. And it makes this big K, paints it blue. A big O, all this. And I'm starting to look, and then it missed the dot on the eye. And it took 2 minutes to paint the entire background screen, because it's a 1 megahertz processor. Well, they had taken the font and made it bigger. We had moved the dot on the eye because it looked better, moved to the left 1 pixel or something. And so what I learned was I couldn't even move the dot on the eye and be Commodore 64 compatible. So what we did to fix it, we grabbed another one. It was called Bricklane, where you lay a ROM right on another one and you take 2 pins. I had a signal, it was high for 128 and low for 64 mode. I just ran it to the two different chip selects. So we found we couldn't even move the dot on the eye of the thing. I had to put all the glitches back in, the external lines. Being a good old hardware engineer, I went and tried to fix up all the glitches. People were using the glitches badly, but I had to put them back in to be 64 compatible. So, how are we doing on, it's 2 o'clock? Yes.
If I may interrupt.
Yes,
I can't stay too long, or too much longer. And I was thinking maybe people have some questions.
Okay, yeah, that'd be great, because...
What do you think?
Yes, please do.
Yeah, so, come on. So, I'm still amazed that there are people that come out here. I haven't seen this many Commodore 64s in one place in a very long time. And it's kind of awesome. Although I must say, that's the wrong font.
Sorry.
But it's right on your t-shirt. So thank you. But anybody have any questions? And things you've wondered about?
Turn the projector off.
Yeah, go ahead and turn the
projector off.
Yeah. And the answer to your question is yes, I can.
We were talking at our last meeting about how Jack came up with the name Commodore, and I think you've heard various versions. Where do you have one?
So the story he told is impossible. He said that he wanted to name the company General. But that was taken, General Electric and other such things, and that he was in a cab in Berlin, and
a car cut him off and stopped. The cab had to stop short, and it was an Opel Commodore. And that car didn't come out until after he had made that decision. So I have no idea where the name came from, and apparently he didn't remember. I also heard this story. He wanted General, and it was taken, and so was Admiral, so he went to Commodore.
But this was during calculators?
Typewriters.
Typewriters,
yeah. So this would have been 1958.
Right. By the way Leonard and I met was at the Commodore 64 anniversary, which had a rare appearance by Jack Tramiel, and we ran into each other. And he did. He told all the stories. I had been a teletype repairman, and he had been a typewriter repairman, yeah. Both in the service, and I had known. So, well, here, I've got a question for you.
Yes, sir.
So when we get to the CS ship of 85,
right.
We arrive. One of the things we noticed is we didn't have any hotel room reservations. So I do what you do. I grabbed the Saul Davidson was the CEO, president at the time. I grabbed the secretary who's got, put a credit card in her hand. I walked the credit card, still in her hand, up to the counter and, get a room for three of the nights. But did you get your hotel room canceled?
We left.
Yeah, so. You were at the Stardust, right?
At the
85 CES.
Yeah.
Because I was standing next to the guy who canceled your reservations.
Yeah. Well, contrary to the common stories, Dad quit at CES. It wasn't at wasn't at the board meeting. He had the board meeting a month later.
Right.
So he quit and we left.
So I'm talking about the one where you were with the TARP.
The one in summer of 85.
No.
January.
The first time I talked with Jack
right.
was at the first CES where he was there with Atari.
Okay.
And we were there, and I was there with 128.
That was the 80. One with the big billboard, Welcome to Atari Country?
It's the one, I have a picture. It's the one that has a big picture of a Commodore ship.
Oh.
Same thing. Okay. So, yeah, we had ours that looked like a ship. But that year, we got there and our hotel rooms were canceled. And we were told they were done by Atari, and I hope it was, because I stood next to, I saw Yash Terkler standing next to Pat McAllister.
Right.
And they were canceling your hotel rooms at the Stardust.
That would have been unkind.
But ours had been canceled by you guys. Was what we
Seems unlikely. I'm pretty sure we were staying at the Sands.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because okay. It still existed.
Gotcha.
Right.
Gotcha.
No one would ever do anything nasty like that. No.
Well, that wasn't you guys in the white car driving around the door?
Black cars.
No.
So, I have a question about the CES. Michael Tomczyk told me that in the 8-bit system...
Did you say Tomczyk?
The pronunciation
Believe
for me.
Nothing Michael Tomczyk
okay.
says.
Thank you.
Except his name.
Okay. Was there like a culture of a void ball demo in 8-bit systems as well for the CES? Was there ever like a demo with a bouncing ball or something like that before the Amiga? Because I heard.
Are you talking about the Amiga?
I do not remember one.
Okay.
For the Commodore 64, I don't.
Any 8-bit systems where it would have been cool to show a ball or something?
I do not remember.
Okay.
One. Yes. Tomczyk tells. Lots of interesting stories.
He did the VIC-20.
So, trying to remember what year it was. It was probably about 5 years ago. A film crew came out to visit Dad to interview him for a documentary, which is supposed to come out later this year.
Oh, wow.
And at one point, the interviewer asks him about this, quote, famous meeting in London where the VIC-20 was designed. And Dad turns to me, goes, because that was the meeting where Mike Tomczyk claims to have specified what the machine should do and got input from all of the people and laid out everything in the system. And the meeting never occurred. The machine was designed 6 months earlier,
and after it was done was the first time Tom Check saw one. And I know this because I was at the meeting where we showed it to the marketing people, and Mike was sitting next to me, and he kept going, "How does that work? What's that for?" It was really and
then
reading,
marketing guy.
And reading the story, I just cracked up. But people's memories are fallible, and some are more fallible than others.
Very different.
My first year, I just assumed, my first year of college, I just assumed that I would work for CommVEx during the summer. So I just, you know, first day after school ended, you know, I was ready to go to work, Dad. And he's like, why are you getting in the car? Well, I assume I'm going to be working for you over the summer. Why? Because I always did. Well, so? All right, fine, come with me. And we went to the office and went to the people that were designing the calculators at the time and said to the guy in charge of the calculator thing, "This is my son Leonard. Have him do something useful." And that was all. That was the instructions I got for the summer. And I designed calculators and did all sorts of wonderful things. It was really cool. The next year, I thought, okay, he doesn't want me to work for him during the summer. So I went and got a summer job at the Ames Research Center, doing really exciting stuff. I was counting craters on Mars. Really, really great. And when I didn't get in the car that first day, I said, "So where are you going?" "I'm going to..." I got his job at the Ames Research Center. "What did you do that for?" So I worked for him for summers after that, and we didn't have to discuss it in advance. Yeah.
So I heard a lot of versions, and as you said, people's memories are fallible, of why Atari did not sell the NES. And I'm curious, were you involved in that? Do you know... what version? Was there ever a chance of it?
I do not believe there was ever a chance of it. I was not involved at all.
Okay.
For the first 6 months and almost year and a half of Atari,
okay,
we were really, really, really busy working on the SD.
Okay.
And anything else, we ignored.
Okay.
Going from design concept to working prototype in cases at CES in 6 months.
That's hard.
Took some effort. And paying attention to little things like Nintendo.
Right.
Was not anything we...
Plus, some of the engineers got there that had just left Commodore, they arrived to have their trailers padlocked by the FBI, Doug Wren.
Yeah.
Who made the Wall Street Journal front page? Good for Doug.
Yeah, there was a monstrous pissing match.
It was.
Between Commodore and Amiga and Atari and all sorts of stuff, with lawsuits going back and forth. And it was.
They admitted they had stuck stuff in the, taken the whole design of the Z80 and stuffed it in the shredder before leaving, and then took the mag tapes with them. They admitted that part. So that's what was started on.
Yeah, it was bizarre.
I
have
yes.
one question. Do you remember when the first time you really think deeply about Nikola Tesla?
About Nikola Tesla.
Yes, the moment you...
No, I certainly was familiar with him because of the Tesla coil.
And a pump, right?
And the following question.
But
do
no.
you think? Did you think your father once kind of got into thinking about Nikola Tesla?
My guess is he would not have recognized the name.
Okay, but then... Back then, Nikola Tesla's work wasn't so recognized, right?
And my father was a
profoundly uninterested in technology person. This will come as a shock to some of you.
A computer company better than.
Yeah. The first computer system that my father was comfortable using was an Apple iPad. And just because it was intuitive and he could do things, but completely illiterate on computers.
But unlike you, you are.
I'm a nerd.
Thank you.
Very, very much a nerd.
Yes, we are.
Were you involved very much with CES in the late 80s, mid 80s to early 90s?
With Atari.
With Atari.
Yeah. I was in this town many times, and like Bill, except at the software end instead of the hardware end, you would get a piece of hardware to demo, and you had to write a demo, and you didn't get the hardware till the night before the show opened.
Like meeting John Fagan's 5
yeah.
minutes before.
I think the worst one of those for me was when that happened in Hanover. So I got the prototype of the hardware at 3 in the morning, Hanover time, and I had just flown over, and I had to write code for hardware that didn't work the way it was specified. Prior to a show, bad things happen. Do you have a question?
Yeah, so what was your favorite, while working at Commodore and after the release of 64, what was your favorite Commodore 64 game?
My favorite Commodore 64
game? If you had one. What did you find yourself playing most of?
Oh, I'm trying to remember the name. Damn it.
Describe it. Yeah, the RLG Jumpman
probably
was one of the more popular.
Maybe wow. In that box. a maze that you jump through.
Jumpman?
Probably. Sounds right. Huh. And the most amazing piece of software that I remember well for the Commodore 64 was, of course, anything written by Jeff Minter. just awesome stuff.
So I have a question.
Yes.
So you said then you guys, your dad left at CES of, it would have been 84 then.
Yeah.
So that picture I have of him showing the two computers.
Yeah, was at that show.
Right, but then, yeah. I mean, so that really is the cusp of him leaving, and like a couple days later he's gone.
Yeah.
Wow.
So that was a very strange show.
And they didn't tell us right away, you know, so we felt a bump. And then only started figuring out as they tried out different rumors on us to see which ones would, you know, pass muster.
Yeah, so three things happened at the same time. And I guess you guys are the first people to hear this. Because everyone involved is now dead. So it's okay. So Commodore passed $1 billion in sales that preceding 12 months.
Right.
It was the 25th anniversary of Commodore as a company, so 1984 starting 59. And so there was a big party. And something that sounds completely unrelated, a new version of the Corvette came out that year. And my dad loved it, thought it was just awesome. So my two brothers and I bought him one. And my younger brother took him around to Chevy showrooms to figure out exactly what interior and style and everything else he wanted. And then bought that car, and Sam and Gary drove it up to Vegas. And at a low point in CES, Gary had figured some reason to take Dad out the front entrance of the hotel, and Dad goes, "That's the car. That's exactly what I wanted." And he walks over to it, and he walks around, he's at the right interior, it's the right color, and he misses this perfect, and Gary reaches into his pocket, hands him the keys.
Oh.
Which was awesome. And then the next day, he had a meeting with Irving Newell. And Irving was using company assets like they were his own.
Like the jet.
And Dad didn't like that and said that was wrong. And said, you can't do that while I'm president. And Irving said, goodbye. So he left, went back to his room, got my mom, they packed and hopped in the car and drove home. Huh. So it was convenient that the car was there. Otherwise, we didn't have plane reservations.
You guys just heard it for the first time publicly. He's told some CBM family before.
Yeah.
This is the first time.
But everyone involved is no longer with us. So.
And then they tried rumors on us, like saying, well, we just hit a billion, but we felt he couldn't take us to 10 billion. And we went, what? No, he grew it to this. You know, so they would try different things. One was that they wouldn't promote you to, like, be a vice president. That was one of the rumors they tried on us.
Yeah, well, given that I didn't actually work for Commodore at the time, that was...
management, you know, was just...
Yeah, the rumor, the story I heard many times was that... Dad wanted his sons to run the company,
right.
And we were obviously incompetent, so we couldn't do that, so they had to get rid of him.
And meanwhile, Sam was running Commodore Tokyo, you know, for several years at that time.
Yeah, he was running Commodore Japan, and in fact continued to do it for a couple of months after Dad left.
Yes, that's part of my stories, actually. Is.
So, yeah.
Okay, so the story you just told, that transpired in 1984.
Yeah, beginning of 84.
So the Commodore LCD with the modular phone port in the side.
Right.
What year was that?
85.
85.
So they're back as Atari by now.
Okay.
But I'm over on the
Commodore. I need to show you this later.
Okay. Any other questions?
Leonard, what is your opinion of these Brian Bagnall books here?
I haven't read them.
Oh, you haven't?
He signed some, but I have not read them.
I was wondering if they are accurate or not. So.
Nothing is accurate.
Oh. Okay.
I've actually spent about a decade bashing my head against the California Department of Education,
okay.
Trying to convince them of a really silly idea, which is that textbooks need to be accurate. and failing miserably. If textbooks are inaccurate, there's no way those are. I did talk to Brian a couple of times, so hopefully what is in there, I think there's a quote from me on the back, which I didn't know until I saw a picture somewhere. So hopefully the questions he asked me I answered correctly. And he transcribed what I said correctly, but I don't know.
And Leonard's correct to some of the things I misspoke on or said just completely wrong. So, as he said, your memory.
Since they mentioned the book, in it, he seems to think that your father was obsessed with keeping the Japanese out of the American market. Did you say that was accurate?
No, that is not accurate. He was obsessed with not having successful competition. He didn't care whether it was the Japanese or anybody else.
I believe he understood that he needed Japan and Germany to be what he was.
Yeah.
And other people weren't in Japan, and here we have an office full of Japanese-speaking people, and that was our angle and our edge, you know, for mass production.
One of the examples he gives is your father had a chance to lock in the licensing rights for Donkey Kong early, before anyone else in the United States. And then the last second, he failed.
Can't imagine how that's true.
On the last second, he bailed out of the deal because he was afraid that would give them a bigger foothold.
Can't imagine how that's true. Donkey Kong was on the Atari.
Yes, that was even before that. He was to be the first one, according to the book.
Nah.
My understanding is your dad wasn't obsessed with it. The games wasn't the 64 for him. It was educational and the stuff you could do with it. That's what drove his interest in the 64. So I couldn't believe he'd have any.
So it was computing, the whole power for the masses, not the classes thing. Yeah. So you've probably heard that before. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Any truth to the fact that, or not, maybe not a fact, Commodore had the opportunity to purchase Apple early on?
Yeah.
None whatsoever.
Oh, I thought that was in the anniversary. He talked about his talks with Steve Jobs.
Yeah, so
Steve won in 45, and Jack Tramiel said on stage something about an offer of 10,000, and kind of
so the,
money from there on.
What happened? And you can go back, and that talk is on the web, so you can listen to it. It was an hour long. I don't remember everything he said. But basically, at one point, while the PET was being designed, Jobs, and I don't remember if was there or not, came in to talk to Commodore about marketing the Apple computer. Mm. And Dad said, we've got our own. We're going to make one as well. But if you're using our processor, here are some samples. But good luck.
Commodore Japan was in the news recently because Satoru Iwata of Nintendo, who recently passed away, used to port a few games for it. What happened to Commodore Japan?
I have no idea. So when we left Commodore in January of 84 and dove pretty quickly into Atari, my direct association with Commodore was non-existent. So Bill will know a lot more about it than I, no idea. I assume they did good engineering because they always did.
And there's a movie out called, by Dave Haney, called Deathbed Vigil. I won't even watch it because it's too sad. You know, so the life after me, I did the same thing. It's like, I don't need to hear about this coming apart, you know, because this had been Camelot when I had been there.
Yeah, watching Commodore slowly sort of shrivel up and die was uncomfortable. Yeah.
For either of you, individually or whatever, just kind of fantasy conjecture of how the products and the industry would have gone if, you know, companies like Commodore and Atari were still around or didn't all go to where the PC went initially, you know, hardware-wise, computer culture-wise. Do you guys have any idealizations from back there of how you would have loved it to go from a product and user perspective? Or just, you know, things happen the way they do and modular is the easiest and best ever?
Speculation is hard to make, especially about the future, as Yogi Berra said. Who knows? Trying to predict what would have happened
under different... accurate prediction. I'm just talking about a dream scenario, something you would have loved to see.
You got to try it at Atari, just different company, right?
Yeah, I mean, we tried to do again at Atari what Commodore did. The ST was an attempt to make a low-priced, high-powered computer with the characteristics that seem to be the direction of the future. So a whole mouse-based graphical interface
desktop
thing.
Right.
I keep kicking myself that I didn't insist on this more. But I had an idea that we should have done a TV commercial where someone was using a mouse to draw an Apple logo, in which at the time was in color. And the only machine with a graphical user interface that could have drawn that logo was an ST. And I couldn't decide whether we were going to have the people at Apple doing that, but they couldn't use their own machine or what, but it never went anywhere. So the ST family of computers is actually quite successful in Europe. And we said that the reason for that was the phrase, no one was ever fired for buying IBM, had never been translated into German. So back in the mid-70s, do you ever feel old when you say things like that? Yeah. So back in the mid-70s, I remember, you know, standing around talking to people in the computer industry, talking about what people would use these things for. And of course, the reason anyone would buy a PET, I've seen one of those before.
wrong font.
Excuse me?
I said wrong font.
I can't tell from it. No, on the word Commodore?
No, I'm sure.
Yeah. Please.
I knew you were sensitive.
My eyesight's not that bad. So the only reason anyone would buy one of these, or the primary reason, would be to learn to program. Because as we know, that's what everyone wants to do with computers. That turned out to be incorrect. Every pundit in the computer industry got that wrong almost every time. What people would wind up using computers for. The only person that ever made a prediction that came close to true was actually Nolan Bushnell. I was talking to him in the, would have been about 87, and he said, people are going to use computers on networks for social things, and in order to make that happen, we have to get women involved. He said girls. And you need to make it friendly enough that you can use it, and people are just going to do social stuff. He didn't say it would be, social networking, because the term didn't exist yet. But that was the closest thing to a correct prediction ever made. Yeah.
The Italian company that owns the rights to the Commodore name now is releasing a phone called the Commodore PET.
I saw that.
It's going to have a built-in 64 emulator and Amiga emulator. Are you glad that even though you're not connected to it, that the brand name is living on? And
they're using the wrong damn font. I saw the picture.
It's
the wrong damn font. But
a whole other generation will be exposed to some aspect.
I hope so.
The company is a scam. They don't own. They filed for a registered trademark, but they did not obtain the trademark. They did not license the copyright, which way they would have had to license from us. And we asked them, did you license the Commodore logo from the successors of Tulip? And they never replied. So they never passed the due diligence. I asked, my colleague asked, and Trevor Dickinson asked, and they never replied. So we never went to this step of licensing the ROM required for the emulation. And what they say, well, anybody can register a £1 company in the UK and call it Commodore, right? Or you can call it Amiga, you can call it whatever, Tramiel's company, and it doesn't make it the real one. So we are waiting to see what will happen, actually. But
it's a scam. No idea what the legalities there are. I am sure they're complicated. Yeah.
Two real quick questions. Is it Tramiel or Tramiel?
Tramiel. Rhymes with Dunwell.
Gotcha. Have you thought about writing a book yourself? I admire you and your family. And your dad's been maligned a couple times by other people.
Really?
No. A couple times.
Oh. I mean, people that weren't even aligned back then.
Right.
I get defensive about that, too.
What he did, being all about that.
A lot of the Holocaust-related stuff is documented in a couple of places, and that was incredibly important to him. The rest of the story, he didn't think it was important. He did not think it was important at all.
Now, Leonard, I'll tell you that when your father passed away, I sat my son down, and I told him about your dad's life. And kind of what it was, look what this man did. And I told my son he can do anything, too. And when your dad says, I set out to make a company to do this, and I succeeded, that's the one person, the one statement I've heard where it's not ego, it's just a simple statement of true fact as to what he did for the industry.
Yep, took a lot of work, a lot of perseverance,
yep.
An incredible amount of skill, and to an extent that he probably would never acknowledge an awful lot of luck. But so I got another convention to get to. But anything else?
Leonard and Bill, before you separate or go your separate ways, we have cake. We have 30th anniversary cake here. That we can serve you.
Well, that's obviously for Bill.
You have to cut it. You have to cut it and have a piece of it. So it's right there.
Twist my arm.
Okay. 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 We'll get it over there.
Thank you.
Are we gonna be able to enjoy your company?
The platter of the nut is over there, I hope.
I've had it in storage for years.
I want to say thank you.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah. Well, I was telling something earlier how.